We're glad you're here today. We invite you to sing with us. Our God leads us through the valley. You never said it would be easy. You never said there'd be no pain. But you promised you'd go with me, and your promises you always keep. I confess, sing it at home. Lord, I confess how much I need you. I confess that I am weak. I can't promise I won't fail you, but your promises will not fail me. When I'm in the valley, when I'm in the valley, I will fear no evil. When enemies surround me, you prepare a table. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me. Oh, there is beauty in the struggle. Sing with us. There is beauty in the struggle. You don't waste a single day. Your presence is my shelter. Your presence is my victory. Oh. When I'm in the valley, I will fear no evil. When enemies surround me, to know, oh, you are faithful. And I can't see it all, but I have seen enough to know, oh, you are faithful. I can't see it all.
Still have an opportunity to worship God, to give Him our praise. That's what we're gonna do today.
I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm.
Oh, church, it is so good to worship with you today. We're so glad that you're here. Today is the day that the Lord has made, and because of that, we can rejoice in it. And regardless of the trials, the frustrations we face, we worship through it. Our God is bigger. Our God is greater. Yes, he is. We're so glad that you're here. Why don't you do me a favor? Take a few seconds. And if you have not looked at the people around you where you are today, maybe you've got a little sleep still in your eyes. Look at each other. Tell each other how much you love one another. And then also say hi to somebody in the chat. To the sinner's ears it may sound strange that freedom could be found through death and pain. While sinless perfection took the blame, but hallelujah. Won't you sing this with me? For our pardon.
For our pardon it would take the cross.
Salvation.
Salvation paid for at the highest cost. Our redemption gained at heaven's lost. Oh, hallelujah.
What can wash
away my sin? Nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood.
There's nothing.
There's nothing strong enough to sing against what love is done without stretched hand. And now salvation flows for every man. Oh, hallelujah. Whosoever calls upon his name will find their guilt and burden rolled away and rise up to their feet forever changed. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you. think on that today. Sing it.
Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, oh, oh.
Would you pray with me, Father? As we worship you today in this place, and God, in every place that's watching, we acknowledge your goodness, we exalt your holy presence. And God, today as we sing and as we make much of God, we make much of you, we remember your cross and the blood that you shed for us there. And God, we thank you that you made a way when there was no way. And so God, out of gratitude in our hearts, we worship you today. God, we ask that you would heal our land. And we ask that your Holy Spirit would move in power, not just as we worship and as we study your word today in our various places, God, but across this country and across our world. God, we pray for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit in such a powerful way that it would be unmistakable that you were moving, that you are moving in power and in might. God, we worship you and we thank you. God, move in this place. We will respond to you.
Peace, bring it all to peace. The storm surrounding me, let it break. At your name still, call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave. At your name, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, breathe. Call these bones to live. Call these lungs to sing once again. Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, 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 you make the darkness tremble. Silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus,
your name will not be overcome. We're about to enter into our time of giving, and that is accessible while we're on the online platform right up here over my shoulder. You can click that tab, and it will take you directly to our giving page. We've been saying this now for a few weeks, but I just want to reiterate so that everybody understands and we are clear. As this coronavirus has impacted our economy more and more people have found themselves out of jobs, I just want you to know, as a church, we don't expect anything out of you in this. Now, what I mean by that is specifically for those of us who are struggling financially, if you are one of those who has lost a job or has been cut back in hours and you're not sure that you can do this and feed your family, then feed your family. Take care of your house first, and then give out of whatever abundance you have. For those of you who are capable and able, who have been blessed during this time, we would ask you and encourage you, if you can, to not only give, but maybe consider giving above your normal gift during this time. We're going to be pushing to help people in our community and people in our church family as needs begin to increase over the next several weeks. So I'm going to pray over our time of giving that for those of us who are able, that our money would be blessed by God, that it would be multiplied by God. And for those of us who are not able, that we would still be willing to express generosity in our time and in our service and in our love to one of another. So let's pray, and then we will continue worshiping through giving. Father God, we praise you today for the technology that allows us to be together. God, we praise you for the opportunity to make much of your name, even in a weird way. God, I pray right now that you be with our tithes and our offerings, that God, that they would be given cheerfully and not as a compulsory gift, but God, that we would be excited to partner in ministry with where you're going and what you're calling us to do. God, I pray that you would bless this money and multiply it so that much can be done for people who are in need, so that much can be done so that they might know the love of the Savior. God, we praise you for the opportunity to serve you. We praise you for the opportunity to be generous. In your name we pray, amen. Hello, Aviator Church, and welcome back to our online platform where we are hosting our church services during the coronavirus shelter-in-place orders that are happening around the state of Kansas. I hate, honestly, that we have to do church like this because I miss seeing all of your beautiful faces, but I'm so grateful that we have the capabilities to do this so we can still join together and worship together and laugh together in the chat and experience fellowship with one another, even if it's not the way that we would like it to be. I will tell you, last week I got a lot of checks in on me of making sure that I was safe after my dish strainer illustration from my wife. I'm just happy to tell you that my wife is a lot slower as a pregnant woman, and so I could get away from her really quick. So I did survive, but I appreciate you guys checking in on me to make sure that I was safe. It means a lot. As we are getting ready to kind of continue into this season, the idea of checking in on people is something that I want to make sure that we at Aviator are really purposeful in. Those of you who have been here for a while, I'm just going to say it. I'm going to trust that you're saying it at home with me. You know that our mission, our vision, and our process is to love God and love others. And we talked a few weeks ago, back when the possibility of a shutdown was looming, we had talked about launching something called Luglow Mobile. And before we jump into the message, I do want to make sure that you guys are aware that we are wanting to be a blessing to the people both in our communities and also in our church family. For people who are struggling during this time financially, we want to do everything we can do to be a blessing and to meet needs of people, because quite frankly, that's the example Jesus gave us. He met needs first physically, and then he dealt with spiritual needs. And so I want to just point this out to you as we're getting ready to do this. I want to make sure that you're aware of the fact that we have a setup in place on our website to make sure that people have an opportunity to submit needs that we can meet, and people can volunteer to try to meet needs. And so I want to walk you through it. It's a three-step process. I made it as easy as we can. Number one, you're going to want to go to aviatorchurch.com. So if you are in a position of need financially, or if you know somebody who is, if you can send them or go yourself to aviatorchurch.com. Number two, across the top, we have a bunch of tabs, and there's one that says Luglow Mobile. This idea of loving God and loving others, we want to take it on the road. So it may be delivering groceries, it may be trying to help somebody with a busted up car, whatever thing we can be doing as businesses are shutting down, we want to try to fill the void. And so if somebody, again, has a need, they'll go to Aviator Church, go to the Luglow Mobile tab, and then there is a request aid form. And so all it is basic information so that we can get a hold of you, and then an opportunity for you to submit what the need is that you're needing met so that we can try to put the right people in touch with you. There's also a place if you're like, you know, I'm not in a position where I'm needing help right now, but I would love to help. If you follow these same exact things right next to the request aid form, there's a volunteer form. Let us know that you're interested in helping during this time, and we can reach out to you and make sure that like I said, the more people we can put in the network of people looking to help, the more likely that we're going to be able to reach and meet needs for people during this time. Just because we are not in the building does not mean that we are not still the church. And so this is a chance that you have just to be the hands and feet of Jesus in our community during a time when they definitely need someone to be the hands and feet of Jesus. So one last time, aviatorchurch.com, Luglow Mobile tab, and then you can click on the request aid form or you can click on the volunteer form. If that's what you would like to do. I just want to take a second away from the message, which of course will be about 25 minutes, right? I tried last time and I got to about 32 and that was pretty good. But we're going to talk today actually about a sermon that went way, way longer than that. We're going to continue today our series on the B list, and we're going to, as we're doing this, what we're looking at is the B list stories in the Bible. It's the stories in Scripture that we don't always pay attention to. It's the stories in the Bible that often get overlooked. And last week I introduced a story to you that was actually an A list character with a B list story. If you'll remember, it was the story of Jesus and that he used a fish to pay a temple tax. And it's an awesome miracle, and it's Jesus who's the biggest A-list star in the Bible. And yet that's a story that often gets overlooked. And today we're going to do kind of a similar thing. Today we're going to look at a story about Paul, which of course Paul is a name that most people who have spent any time in the Bible or in Sunday school, it's a name that most of you will know. Paul is the guy who wrote basically everything in the New Testament after Acts and before Revelation. He is a big time character in the Bible. And yet there's a story that we're going to look at today that I think often gets overlooked. It is a B-list story. And the story is, don't fall asleep during the sermon. Or else. Now, here's the thing. I know you would never fall asleep during the sermon because I tend to yell very randomly. I know you would never fall asleep during the sermon. That would never be a thing that would happen. But again, in order to help you, especially families, my intention today is to make this message short enough that your kids don't have an opportunity to fall asleep, that you don't start dozing off because you're so tired. For those of you who slept in all the way up until the very last possible second, that man, you can watch about 30 minutes of a message and then go right back to bed. Okay, I'm going to do my best to keep it short. I'm going to tell you in advance, though, Paul did not have the same concern for his people. Paul did not have the same concern for the people who were listening to him. So before we look at Paul's message and what happens when you fall asleep during the sermon, I just want to take a second and pray over our time together that even though we are separated by distance, that we would be united in our searching and in our fellowship in the name of Jesus Christ, and that we would be united as the service ends today in our desire to go and take the love of Christ into our communities. I love you guys. Man, I miss you. I miss having people in the room, but I'm so glad that you're here today. Let's pray. Father God, we just ask right now that you would be in the midst of this group of people, in the midst of the online chat, in the midst of me and my words as I flub over them. God, I just pray right now that you would use a broken speaker, that you would use a broken vessel to convey a perfect message. God, as we look at what happens when you fall asleep during the sermon today, God, I pray that you would open our eyes that we might not fall asleep in our walk with you. We love you. It's in your name we pray. And everyone in the chat said, amen. You're going to have to type it. Okay, so we're jumping into Acts chapter 20, and we're going to start in verse 7. And we're just going to kind of go right through it, and I'm going to talk about it as we go. And it says this in verse 7, on the first day of the week when they were gathered together to break bread. So real quick, just a couple things. On the first day of the week, that would be when the church would get together for their corporate worship time. And this phrase to break bread is often used specifically about taking Lord's Supper or communion or whatever you call it. So the implication here is that this is the church, the body coming together for teaching and for corporate worship time. So on the first day of the week, they gathered together to break bread. Paul talked with them, intending to depart the next day, and he prolonged his speech until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where they were gathered. Now, a couple of things. Number one, Paul talked. The word that is used here for talked is kind of a word that would mean like an intentional dialogue. This is Paul preaching. This is Paul talking to the people, and he's preaching, as a pastor with a heavy heart, because he's doing what? He's intending to depart the next day. And here's the thing, we'll get into this a little bit more later, but when it says that he was intending to depart, Paul knows something in this moment, and it is that he likely will never be back with this group of believers again. You see, Paul is being drawn to go to Jerusalem, and there's a very good chance that he'll be imprisoned and maybe killed when he gets there. And so Paul, you kind of got to look at it as Paul's a guy who went around and he planted churches. He was a missionary, and he just planted churches all over the place. He's actually in Asia right now, and he loves the people who he's worked with, and he's planted these ministries, and now he's kind of coming to the end of it, and anybody who's ever left a ministry or a job that they were passionate about, not just some, you know, a J-O-B, but like a career, a calling, something that you were passionate about, you know that at the end of that, it's so hard to leave. I remember when I told my youth group in Crosspoint before I came down here that I was leaving, I had a letter written, I did a little lesson, and I was going to read my letter, and I made it about 6 words into it, and started getting a little teary-eyed, and a couple of my kids who I loved all of the youth group members the same, officially, but a couple of my kids who were some of my favorite kids knew it was coming already, and they were already crying, and I'm, right? And I just wanted to tell them all of the things, and I wanted to make sure they had all of the wisdom, and man, I just loved them so much, and it was so hard to be leaving those kids, because I'd spent so many nights with them watching basketball games and praying with them and doing all the stuff that I could do. And so anyways, there's this feeling of just like, I want to give you every bit of wisdom that I have. And that's where Paul is. Paul is talking with them, knowing he's going to depart the next day, and that he probably will never turn. And he did what us pastors tend to do when we're in a spot like that. He prolonged his speech. Now listen, I get a hard time around here a lot because I say, I'm going to try to keep it short today. And then I just inevitably go 2 times longer than I intended to. But listen to this. He prolonged his speech until midnight. Now, I don't want to hear anything ever again from any of you people, because man, I'll go like 14 minutes over, and that's a long sermon. This joker preached until midnight because he loves these people, and he's leaving them, and he wants to give them everything they need to know. But there's a couple of factors that are going to be important for the next part of the story here. It says that there was many lamps in the upper room. Where we were gathered. There's many lamps. Now, these would be oil-burning lamps, which would do a couple of things. Number one, they would heat the room up. Now, have you guys ever, like, sat in a room, like, especially, like, after you eat or some other time when you kind of are, like, hitting a little lull in the day, and you sit down, and the warmer the room is, you just kind of, like, start to be, I'm sleepy. My children don't do this, but man, I do. Anytime the room is warm, I sit down, it's like, oh man, this is great nap climate, right? Well, here's the other thing that those lamps would have done. They would have burned up oxygen in the room. And so the oxygen is getting thinner and thinner. The room is getting warmer and warmer. The preacher is preaching on and on and on all the way until midnight, and people start to get tired. And so they're in the upper room. They're gathered until midnight, and here's what happens. Verse 9, a young man named Eutychus, which, by the way, that is absolutely in the running for the name of our next child. Just kidding, probably not. We call him Udy. Yeah, it's cute. A man named Eutychus was sitting at the window. And by the way, it's important to recognize he's a young man. This is an actual word in the Greek that would put him between the ages of 8 and 14. And so he's a young man. He's a kid. Eutychus is sitting at the window up there. Now, they don't have glass panes in the window. There would be a little bit of a thatch work over the window to keep bugs out, but they could just release that and lay it down the building. So he's sitting at the window, and he sank into a deep sleep as Paul talked still longer. Can you hear the way he just kept going? Oh, my gosh, like poor Eutychus. He's sitting there, probably got dragged there by his dad, and he's sitting there and listening and listening and listening. 1 hour in, 2 hours in, 3 hours in, 5 hours in, and finally it gets to midnight, and the kid's like, I can't do it anymore, man. I cannot do this anymore. He starts nodding off, and finally he falls into a deep sleep. Now, how deep was it? Right, you ready? And being overcome by sleep, he fell down from the third story and was taken up dead. That's how deep it was. He was so sleepy that he was overcome by the sleep, and he was sitting. It's not funny. It's not. This is one of those things that's serious, guys. I'm going to need you to not laugh about this, okay? He was sitting by the window, and he falls into this deep sleep. You guys ever watch? Like, I had this happen to me one time. I was sitting in church, and I was really tired, and I had my hands kind of like this, and I was just sitting, and I kind of started doing this, like, where I started falling asleep and, like, nodding off. And then at one point, I tilted too far, and I did this number like that, and I looked up, and one of the kids in my youth group was staring right at me with this big old smile. I'm like, hey. Shut up. It's like this deep sleep. You can't stop it. Well, this kid is sitting next to the window, and he's like, and as he falls out of the open window from the third story to his death. He fell down to his death. Now, this is one of those things where I say you shouldn't fall asleep during the sermon, because here's the thing, it's Bible, man. You might die. If you fall asleep during the message today, you might die. Now, you probably won't, but you could. It's a possibility. I'm going to tell a story about a thing that happened in this very room. Because I didn't ask for permission ahead, I'm not going to mention the name. I'm confident that he wouldn't mind, though. I was preaching here one time in this very room at this very stage. And when I got done, I was back in the back of the sanctuary. I was talking to people. We were mingling. And somebody came up to me and said, Dave, I think we have a problem. Dave, we have a problem. I was like, what is it? And they pointed, and sitting up about the middle of the room, there was a gentleman who was kind of slumped over like this. And I was like, oh, no. I bored a guy to death. Bored of God. And so we walk up, and here's the thing. There's like six or seven people already there, and they're standing in a semicircle around him. And everybody's kind of just like, And a couple of people are like, sir, sir. And he wasn't responding. And so finally one lady reached in and kind of like hit him, tapped him on the shoulder. And was like, hey, get up, you know, whatever. And when they did that, the man who was slumped over goes, ugh! Like that, right? And everybody in the room, ugh! It was panic. Like, we all had a minor heart attack right there. But like, in reality, I felt like, oh, no, this guy died while I was preaching. Like, that is a hard thing to come back from. But he was just tired. And I think we've all been there. We've all been there. I mean, not mostly during my sermons, because they're so engaging and lively, but we've all been there. And so this kid falls asleep, and he falls out of the third-story window, and he was taken up dead. Now, what happens next is interesting. It says Paul. Now, mind you, what has Paul been doing this whole time? He's been preaching, preaching and preaching and preaching and preaching. And finally, the only thing that stopped this guy from going on and on and on was literally somebody being so tired they fell out of the window and died. And so Paul went down and bent over him. And taking him in his arms, he said, do not be alarmed, for his life is in him. And when Paul had gone up and had broken bread and eaten, he conversed with them a long while. That's outstanding. He conversed with them a long while until daybreak, and then he so departed. Now, here's the thing. What happens in this passage, it's hard to tell in the English, but this is one of those times where really studying the Greek doesn't help you any either, because it's hard to tell exactly what happened even in the Greek. You see, he goes up to him and he says, do not be alarmed, for his life is in him. One of two things took place in this particular point of the story. Number one, this kid was actually dead, and Paul reached down and picked him up in his arms, and he said, don't worry, guys, I got this. And essentially, he was resurrected back to life. And then Paul went back upstairs, ate a sandwich, and started preaching again. right? That's number one. Number two is this. The way that it's worded, it could be this. He says, don't be alarmed, for life is in him. It's possible the kid falls out of the window, falls down, bang, hits the ground after a three-story fall and is unconscious, right? Either from still sleeping so hard, because I can sleep hard enough, I could probably sleep through a three-story fall. But he's either just knocked, like he's sleeping, like, you know, unconscious sleeping, or he got knocked out by the fall. And when Paul gets down there, somebody who looked dead, he was like, oh, guys, he's fine. He's fine, guys. Don't worry about it. Let's go back upstairs. I want to keep preaching for a while. Either way, let me tell you what's amazing about Paul. No matter what had happened, I'll tell you this. If I'm preaching in this room and the lockdown is lifted and we got people back in the room and somebody stands up to leave the room and all of a sudden they go, ooh, and they fall and they drop and just pass out, just to pass out. I'm going to have a hard time continuing to preach, right? I'm going to want to stop and make sure the person's okay. Like, Paul literally stops, goes down, like, guys, this 8-year-old who fell out of the 3-story window is probably fine. Let's go. I got more preaching to do. You know what's funny about Paul and what I've always appreciated about him is he understands the nature of a relentless call. Paul understands the nature of a relentless call. We mentioned this a little bit earlier, but Paul knows that he's about to head back to Jerusalem. He feels the Holy Spirit is drawing him. He says this several times, both before and after this. And so Paul, knowing that full well, what he says is I know that there's some things that are happening. I know people are tired. I know people wore out, but you need to hear this. Paul had a desire, a relentless desire to fulfill his call. He knew that he had things that he needed to say, that they needed to hear, that they weren't ready yet, and he wanted to build them up. Paul was relentless in his call. I want to skip a little bit ahead in the passage, and I want to read a part of this to show you exactly that. So he finished here, and he bounced around a little bit more, and then on his way back to Jerusalem, he stopped by what seemed to be one of his favorite congregations, one of the favorite ministries that he had planted. It was the church at Ephesus. And when he stopped at the church at Ephesus, he talked to the elders, and later in chapter 20, verse 18, I think is where we're starting, he says this to them, and this is where you can see the desire of Paul recognizing the need for a relentless call on his life. He says this, "You yourselves know how I lived among you the whole time from the first day that I set foot in Asia, serving the Lord with all humility and with tears and with the trials that happened to me through the plots of the Jews," that's the Jewish leaders who were trying to get him killed. "You know that I did not shrink from declaring to you anything that was profitable and teaching you in public and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks of repentance towards God and of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And now behold, I am going to Jerusalem constrained by the Spirit." The Spirit is pulling me to Jerusalem. The Spirit is calling me to Jerusalem. "I'm constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there. Likely he will be put to death." He says, "I don't know what's going to happen, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. But I do," this is the key of it, listen to this, "but I do not account my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and that the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God." Now here's the thing, as we look at this, you can see Paul's heart. His time in ministry is coming to an end. His time as the preacher to the Gentiles is coming to an end. He has set up churches all over the world. He has built relationships with people all over the known world. He has told them about Jesus. He has never stopped. He says, "You know, you've seen me in the tears and the sweat. I've poured everything I have into this." And what's the one thing that drives Paul, even at the very, very end? "That I may finish my course and the ministry that I received from the Lord Jesus." I just have to do this. Nothing else matters. I just have to, it's the most important thing. I just have to do this. Paul's recognition of the importance of a call, of the Christian call, is encouraging and challenging and sometimes discouraging, to be honest, because I look at it and I think, I don't have that. I don't know that I have that. That this drives me to a point where it's where a kid can fall out of the 3rd-story window to his apparent death. When I find out that he's not dead, or gosh, man, if I just raised him from the dead, that I wouldn't stop and talk about that for a minute. He goes right back upstairs and continues trying to fulfill the ministry that Jesus has called him to. Man, could you imagine? We live in a world that's so busy. We live in a world where we don't have time to fulfill the ministry that God's called us to a lot of the times. We got just stuff happening all the time, right? Except that now we don't. We're so busy. Everything's go, 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 go. Except that now it isn't. Have you thought about that? What are you using your time for during this season of the coronavirus lockdown, the shelter-in-place order? What are you doing? You have an opportunity to reprioritize all the things that you think are important. I was actually, where else, on Facebook, because that's where you have social interaction these days. And I have a friend of mine named Jerry Heiderscheidt, and I asked if it was okay if I use this post. He posted a thing on Facebook today, and it kind of hit me, like convicted me a little bit. I want to show it to you. Jerry says this: at the end of this quarantine, do a self-check. Did you read that book you've been putting off? Take that online course? Work on your relationship with spouse, kids, or God? Did you finish that project? Did you start your side hustle? Did you plant your garden? If you didn't, if not, are we really lacking time, or is this a discipline issue? Well, that's something worth recognizing, I guess, today. The question today is this: what needs to change today for you to be relentless? What discipline are you lacking? What thing have you been slacking on? What thing could you improve in that would make you more like Paul, even just a little bit? You know, discipleship, I think sometimes we look at it and think, well, I'm never going to be as good as that guy, or I'm never going to be the Christ follower that person is. Here's the thing: you don't have to be. This isn't a competition against you and other Christians. The whole idea of the Christian walk is every day get a little bit better than you were before. Discipleship is the process by which we go closer and closer to Christ in seeking after him. So today, what needs to change? Literally, what thing can you change today that would cause you to be more of a relentless Christian? Because this season of difficulty, this season of economic hardship, this season of illness where people are dying across the country, is also a season where you have an opportunity to shift priorities, where you have an opportunity to do something different. I love you guys, and I don't want you to be the same when you come back to church in 6 or 8 or 10 or 14 weeks, whenever it is. I want you to be growing on your own. I want you to be growing with your families. I want you to be growing in your community. I want you to be sharing your faith. I want you to feel like Paul. I want you to recognize that you have a call on your life, and that that call is not an optional thing, and it shouldn't be something that you have to do, but it should be something that compels you to do what Christ has called you to. Let's pray. Father God, I pray you make me more like Paul. God, as a pastor, I know I miss the mark still. God, right now I ask that you would embolden me to lead the way that Paul leads. God, to care the way that Paul cares, to love the way that Paul loves. And God, as you draw me closer to you in that, God, I pray that you draw our church closer to you in that as well. God, if we had a room full of people who were committed the way Paul was committed, who sought after you the way Paul sought after you, that God, if we had a room like that, Derby and Winfield would stand no chance. God, the gospel would be too irresistible. God, help us during this season to reprioritize, to recognize the things that are a lack of discipline and not a lack of time. God, help us to seek after you more. God, help us to be relentless today. We love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.